Good morning, everyone. Commissioner John, I'm very pleased to be here with you today. And what I'm going to speak about is not just reflections on 100 years of pandemic flu, but also about other emerging infections. And what I'd like to do is highlight the challenges to the Africa CDC and its partner public health institutes that arise from emerging infections. I generally don't say much about myself, but what I would like to say is that I started to work in Africa for 13 years, beginning in 1976. And when I was assigned from the Center for Disease Control to the first country where I worked long term, I was at a cocktail shortly after I arrived with the Minister of Health. And the Minister of Health said to me, he said, you know, we could do what you're doing and a lot less costly, but we just don't have the resources to do it. And that stuck with me since then. And it is true. It's true that Africa can do the job, their own way of doing the job, with their own resources, but we need to support them rather than imposing from the top what we feel Africa should be doing. So I'll just say a few words about flu, because during the last hundred years, we've learned quite a bit. We've learned about the reservoirs in nature, that they come from waterfowl and also from shore birds. We've also learned that those waterfowl are very important in making the other animals in contact with them infected with the virus, which can then do many different things in many different pathways. And we know that there are constantly emergence of these influenza viruses into humans. We also know that they're very unstable genetically. And you can see here that the emergence has been followed through various different influenza virus species. When there is a shift in the antigenic type of a new virus type develops, it occurs because the stability of these viruses is such that they can easily combine their genetic material. And you can see here a new virus which has sprung off from two original viruses. And in fact, there have been many different introductions of new influenza viruses into human populations since the 1900s or the 20th century. And you can see those on this graph. The new introductions are shown when they begin and then they disappear, or some of them, such as influenza B, continue throughout the period. So the influenza virus, we've learned, is quite unstable, does emerge periodically into non-humans, and sometimes adapts itself for human maintenance. And we know that these viruses cause serious epidemics each year where there is high mortality, 20,000 deaths in Germany, for example, in 2014 to 2015, 217,000 in the European community. And we also know that they periodically emerge and cause pandemics, and this is the 2009 pandemic, which was a complex interaction of viruses from humans and from the swine populations and the poultry populations, which ended up in humans causing the pandemic. And we know that there have been many pandemics since 1918, one in 57, one in 68, one in 2009. And we also know that annual influenza is also very important in mortality. What's important is, though, that today we benchmark on the 1918 pandemic, even though it occurred in situations which don't occur today. There were very close contact of military forces crossing the Atlantic. There were no antibiotics to treat superficial bacterial infections, a whole series of things which made this a very serious epidemic. And we still benchmark on this because we want to be sure that we could be prepared for the most important outbreak or pandemic should it occur. There are vaccines, as you know, for influenza protection, inactivated vaccines, live attenuated cold adapted vaccines, and recombinant protein vaccines. All are finding a role, but most of them take 6 months to develop from the time it's decided what strains go into those vaccines. 6 months, which are very important when a pandemic occurs, because that means we can't prevent infection for 6 months through vaccine. But many countries are developing vaccines, and this is an example of the current influenza immunization policies. And if you look at the Africa area, you'll find that there are only three countries that have policies for vaccines. So this is an area that the Africa CDC will have to address. And they'll have to address this by looking at what data is available about influenza. Here's some data on influenza among pediatric respiratory infections between 1980 and 2009. The first bar on the left, the light green, repeated with each of the countries, shows the importance of influenza in childhood respiratory infections. And this shows that there is, in countries that are more temperate, for example, in South Africa, there's a peak of outbreaks in the winter months, whereas in other countries, influenza appears to be occurring throughout the year. But there's a lack of evidence. In Madagascar has been following influenza from 2002, and they witnessed a very severe outbreak, as you can see in, I can't read the year from here, 2007? 2009? Anyway, there was a major outbreak, and that was studied by the people in Madagascar at the Institut Pasteur and within the government, and also within WHO. And in that one outbreak, there were deaths. There were over 800 deaths associated with that, excess deaths associated with that outbreak. So influenza in Madagascar has been well studied. It's understood what's going on in at least one country. These are the countries, though, that have published data regarding influenza. And on this map, you'll see stars, which indicate where there are WHO collaborating laboratories. And you'll also see colors. And those colors show you the numbers of publications that are coming out about influenza in Africa. Very important to notice, because this is a major gap in our knowledge about influenza, both for Africa and for the rest of the world. So the challenges for CDC Africa and its partners in public health institutes are understanding better the burden of influenza, morbidity and mortality, and would vaccination be useful in Africa, in the elderly? What are the risk factors for serious infections? Which are the populations at risk? And what are the causes of respiratory deaths in elderly populations? And is there a monitoring system for excess pulmonary deaths in those populations? All activities that the Africa CDC and its partners throughout Africa are in a good position to now begin to understand better, with support from partners and others from around the world. And I was very interested to hear from the commissioner the importance of bringing in partners from around the world, including the private sector. So I'm going to move on to other respiratory infections, and this is the plague outbreak in Madagascar in 2017. Again, pneumonic plague shown in red. Now, plague, we all know, is a disease which is caused by a gram-negative bipolar organism. And we understand the life cycle within rats, and then the cycle that transmits it to humans through the rat that leaves a dead rat and bites humans and the humans become infected. A very simple to understand transmission cycle. We understand its clinical manifestations, either a bubo or a pulmonary infection with massive bloody effusion coming out of the lungs. And we also know where countries are reporting plague to WHO. And this shows you the African countries, and three of those that are most important are the Congo, Republic of Congo, Madagascar, and in Africa. I'm sorry, I just can't read these slides. But anyway, you can see where the most important reporting is from Africa, but you can also see the void, which doesn't necessarily mean that plague doesn't exist, it's just not being reported. So this is the plague outbreak in Madagascar in 2017, and this outbreak, as all emerging infections, was what I like to call a Swiss cheese event. As you know, if you want to pass a pencil through four pieces of Swiss cheese, you have to line up those holes so that the arrow can go through. This was James Reason who brought this up back in the 1990s. And those holes in public health represent risk factors, and when the arrow finally goes through, it represents a major public health event. And this is the way I like to think about all emerging public health events. They're Swiss cheese events. But I have to confess another thing, that Swiss cheese does not have holes. This cheese is actually Emmental, but we know it as Swiss cheese. So, the pneumonic plague in Madagascar. Madagascar is a very populous country and has very great mobility of its people through bush taxis, such as you see here. So that's the first hole in the Swiss cheese, if you would. Population that's highly mobile, cramped transportation, and major urban areas. The second is that in one of those transport systems, a 47-year-old woman sat next to a 31-year-old male who was coughing extensively and who actually died during the taxi ride from where he joined the taxi into the coast. In the middle, you can see that person who was infected in the taxi in the red circle, and you can see two people who were infected. On the left is the woman who was infected and who was the first case to be identified as pulmonary plague dying in a major hospital. And on the right, you can see another patient. And that led to an outbreak where there were actually 507 confirmed cases. You can see here on this graph in the gray, the bubonic plague manifestations, and in the red, the pneumonic plague representations. This virus is very stable, fortunately. It hasn't moved a lot genetically, but it is very diverse in its genetics, especially in persons who have pulmonary manifestations. And so what are the major challenges in plague? Well, the major challenges are controlling the rodents, which are a source of protein in many instances, and which occur in many urban and non-urban areas because of improper sanitation, and an absence of rodent control in those areas. But the difficulty is that if you do have a strategy to kill the rodents, then the fleas just leave the rodents and come to humans and carry with them plague if they're infected. So it's a very difficult issue to figure out how to do this, and plague has been known for many, many years, and the solutions are still not there. So challenges for the CDC in Africa, again, does plague exist and cause deaths in other parts of Africa than those that regularly report? Is there a need for point-of-use diagnostic tests that aren't yet developed? What are the best tools for rodent control? Can plague be prevented? And what are the factors that lead to pneumonic transmission? All these are very important understanding that can be developed through collaboration with the network of regional Africa CDC, as well as the public health institutes in countries. And it's very important that Africa CDC move this agenda forward, because it's no longer a problem in industrialized countries. They're no longer interested in the advances that should be occurring. Same is true for SARS-like respiratory syndrome, first identified in August 2012 by an Egyptian doctor working in Saudi Arabia. He reported this against government will. The genetic sequence was placed on the international web, and he lost his job. But ProMedMail was the international web facility which provided this sequence information worldwide. And fortunately, it was available because within a month, there was a person who arrived in London at St. Thomas who had a respiratory syndrome. The virus was a coronavirus, and when it was sequenced, it matched perfectly with the virus that had been sequenced in Saudi Arabia. The importance of making sure that data is shared publicly. This 49-year-old, previously well Qatari male, had a very serious stream of events in his illness. No one else was infected in England. He was isolated because the cause wasn't known. There were no further infections in the hospital. But he did have a stormy course, and unfortunately, after a year, passed away. These are the contacts of this person. In the household, there was another person who was infected, and that person then was admitted to a hospital, and there were three cases that were linked to this case. And MERS coronavirus continues to spread internationally. Fortunately, it's not an illness which spreads easily from person to person. It affects persons who are immunosuppressed. It also affects people in hospitals. As you know, it continues to spread, and there was a major outbreak in South Korea, one imported case, over 300 cases in hospitals because of poor infection control in South Korea. And these nosocomial outbreaks which occur either in immunosuppressed persons or in persons who are not properly shielded from the organism on the hands of health workers or in needles and syringes. We do know a little bit about this, though. We do know that camels carry this virus, and also they carry it in their noses and can spread it to others. We don't know how it's spread. That information has not been forthcoming. But we also know that camel dromedary populations in sub-Saharan Africa are infected with this virus. But we don't know what's happening in humans. So again, a challenge for CDC Africa and its partner public health institutes. How does the MERS coronavirus transmit from camels to humans? That's not understood. The case control studies have either been done and not published or have not been done in Saudi Arabia. Are humans infected in African countries? If so, what is the burden? Is there a need for point-of-use diagnostic tests? Is there a need for human vaccines? If there were a camel vaccine, would transmission to humans still occur? A whole series of activities which are very important because the Africa CDC can influence the global agenda. There are NGOs, public-private partnerships, such as Find Diagnostics, which are working on new diagnostics. If Africa CDC can make its voice heard, perhaps they'll also be working on MERS coronavirus diagnostics. The same for a human vaccine. CEPI is developing a human vaccine. Africa CDC can tell what the use might be for that vaccine in Africa, or whether or not a camel vaccine would be more important. A whole series of issues that Africa CDC can begin to address to help influence the agenda in the North, rather than sitting by as passive observers. Lassa in sub-Saharan Africa, and this is a disease which has been really pretty well neglected for 50 years. We know the basics about it. We know how it's transmitted to humans. We know a few things, but there is a Lassa fever belt in Africa. And fortunately, there's also now a Nigeria CDC. As you know, Nigeria CDC had a meeting about 4 weeks ago, an international conference well attended, where they're beginning to now identify the research agenda, which is important for Africa, in Lassa fever. And again, when the Africa CDC has its regional office in Waho, they'll be able to work closely with the Nigeria CDC to make sure that the knowledge gained from Africa, Nigeria CDC, is applied throughout Africa. You can see here, there's been an epidemic. There's also an understanding of where it's occurring down to the local government authority level in Nigeria. And this data is available on the Nigeria CDC website. Anybody can access it and know what's going on. We also know that Lassa fever in Nigeria this year is causing a major problem. We also know that most of those infections are from nature to humans. They don't incur human-to-human transmission. But Nigeria is doing research. Here's an article that's been published in Lancet on research. And the needs and what those needs are identified as is, number one, government commitment, which the commissioner mentioned earlier. And in addition, a whole series of research activities which have been neglected in laboratory strengthening, in core capacity strengthening, and in research. So these are the activities. We know that there are control measures for the rodent populations, dangerous to human populations. We also know that Nigeria is looking at other ways of PPE to make sure that protection is more adapted to the African continent. And we know that there are rodent control activities that must be done. And think just a little bit outside the box to what Europe is doing with rabies, and think how that might apply to Africa and Lassa. In Europe, baited vaccine is provided in the forests so that foxes and other animals that carry rabies can be vaccinated. They're vaccinated, they're protected, humans are no longer infected, there's no more human rabies occurring in Africa. Could the same thing happen to rodents? Could there be a rodent vaccine, easier to develop than a human vaccine, put on bait, used in areas in the household areas where there are rats, to vaccinate those rats against Lassa and prevent it from transmitting to humans? Just one idea, a crazy idea, but ideas that can be generated if the Africa CDC and its Public Health Institute partners continue to look at the research agenda which the Nigeria CDC is outlining. So, for the issues, are all risk factors for human infection known from Lassa? Is there a need for a human vaccine to prevent infection? Are there sufficient point-of-use diagnostic tests? What measures are most effective in rodent control and grain protection? Are there other possible interventions to prevent human infection? So all these different things are areas where Africa can influence the Northern agenda. CEPI is developing a human vaccine. Is this the right way to go, or should there be other efforts made to prevent Lassa fever from humans? Again, a very important responsibility of Africa CDC and its partners. And finally, and lastly, I'll talk about the Ebola virus, because this is also an area where the Africa CDC is playing a major role and can play an important role in the future. This is that very first Ebola outbreak back in 1976. It's a registry from the outpatient department at the Yambuku Hospital, and you can see in green a person who is circled. He is thought to be the first person that brought Ebola into the health system. He was a schoolmaster, the head of the school at the Yambuku Mission. He brought some wild animal meat, a live wild animal, brought it home, slaughtered it. He became sick a few days later with a fever. He went to the outpatient department and was given an injection for what was epistaxis and a fever, which was thought to be possibly related to malaria. He also had diarrhea. He was given an injection with one of these four needles and syringes, and those four needles and syringes then also made their way into the maternity whenever there was a delivery. A hospital run by missionaries who were not using appropriate infection control procedures. These needles and syringes, some of them were reusable, but they were never sterilized between use. As a result, there was a major outbreak of Ebola, and you can see this outbreak. The red is persons who had contact and needle syringe, health workers and their families in yellow, and needle and syringe contact in red, mainly in the maternity, then moving outwards. And the outbreak had actually stopped by the time the international teams arrived because it burned itself out and people learned what to do to stay away from it. But still, an outbreak which shouldn't have occurred, which occurred because of poor infection control practices in hospitals. Here's the second outbreak a year later at the mission hospital in Tandala, Zaire, about 250 kilometers to the west of Yambuku. The doctor in charge of this hospital had been at the outbreak in Yambuku. He knew that this outbreak was this disease was very contagious by human to human contact, and so he isolated the patient that came into the hospital. And in fact, there was only one clinical case that patient went to the hospital. One contact, a sister, became infected and is thought to have been infected and survived. So in the 5 years that followed that, there was a surveillance system set up by WHO and the Tandala Mission Hospital and the government of DRC at that time, Zaire, to look and see what might be going on in communities in the area as far as Ebola was concerned. The black shows you the sites at which there was a health worker trained to do an investigation of persons who fit the clinical or possible diagnosis of Ebola. That person was then to contact the head doctor at the hospital should there be a case. That patient was taken to the hospital, hospitalized, and a history was taken. During that period, there were actually 21 emergences of Ebola confirmed, not virology confirmed, but immunofluorescence concerned cases of Ebola which were admitted to the hospital, which were diagnosed in that hospital, but which didn't cause outbreaks because infection control procedures were what they should be. Here's the third outbreak in DRC in 1995. Same thing happened. A patient was admitted to the hospital after a chain of transmission that had gone on slowly for about 2 months. When he was admitted to the hospital, he had a blood taken and nurses were taking care of him. Two of those nurses became infected, as you can see from the red. Those nurses then took the infection to another hospital where they worked, and one of them actually had surgery because it was thought the obstructed colon was due to typhoid, and they were trying to relieve the obstruction. They weren't wearing the proper equipment in the emergency room. They became, in the operating theater, they became ill. The people who cleaned up became ill, and then they spread it into the communities. Again, an outbreak of Ebola that would not have happened had infection control been the way it should be. And in 2014, in DRC, Moyembe again, who's the first person to actually have seen patients with Ebola, Moyembe did an investigation of this outbreak and rapidly stopped it. Again, 8 health workers implicated in the chain of transmission. A wife received a live animal from her hunter husband. She butchered it. She became ill. One of her children became ill, went to the health facility, 8 workers became ill and spread it in the community, but it was rapidly stopped by DRC. And of course, in the West Africa, the tragic West Africa outbreak, it was, again, health workers who became infected and took the infection into the communities and spread it. So we need to really do a better job with our infection control activities, but it's very difficult. Because this is a patient of Ebola that was seen at the Tropical Institute in Basel. And you can see here that the initial signs and symptoms are those of any other tropical disease, fever, myalgia, a whole series of things, which makes it difficult for health workers to discern Ebola, but they must. They must begin now to really take advantage of their knowledge and make sure that when patients come in, any suspicion, they're isolated. The African Union, and now the Africa CDC, have become very implicated, as you know, in Ebola in West Africa, and they've been implicated in outbreaks since then by sending well-trained Africans to do the work in those countries. And there's actually a declaration from the African Union on the importance of Africa developing its own capacities. But again, the North has to be constantly reminded that it's a Southern issue, these activities, and they must know what to do. This is some modeling that was done early in the 2014 outbreak in West Africa, which suggested that the money, the most important part of controlling the outbreaks, was getting hospital beds and isolating patients and safe burials. So hospitals were built. Unfortunately, those hospitals didn't get built until after the outbreak had been ended, because it was rapidly understood that the most important way of dealing with Ebola outbreaks and other outbreaks is getting communities on board, empowering communities through their village chiefs and traditional leaders to do the job with the teams that come in. So we haven't really learned two things for Ebola. We haven't learned the importance of infection control and how to get all health facilities to do that, and at the same time, how to engage communities, not only for Ebola, but for many other public health issues. We now have an Ebola vaccine. Hopefully that's having an effect. I know that it's very effective in those people who are vaccinated, if it's distributed to those, and that's the challenge right now in DRC. We know that other health facilities collapse during outbreaks, and children die from other diseases, such as malaria and diarrheal disease. And we know that these cost economies much, much money, as you can see from this slide here. So where do we stand with Ebola outbreaks? Well, fortunately, we have a framework within which we can work. The international health regulations are no longer a regulation which says the North goes down and helps the South. These regulations have at their core strengthened national core capacity for surveillance and control. And it's important that the Africa CDC continue to remind its northern partners that this is what the regulations say. They don't say build up capacity in the North to provide support to the South. They say strengthen the South to do it themselves. The regulations also do have a safety net which does respond globally if countries can't do it themselves, and that's very important in some instances, as it is in the current Ebola outbreak. So what does the Africa CDC need to do in the area of Ebola? Well, maybe the Africa CDC and its partners can understand the best ways to ensure infection control in health facilities. It's time that we stop amplification of emerging infections into outbreaks in our own health facilities. What are the best ways of increasing community ownership and participation? Is it possible to shift the paradigm to rapid detection and response within countries, containment at the source? And will bilateral and multilateral donors increase their investments for national core capacity strengthening in addition to their contributions to a global safety net? The Africa CDC can play a major role and is already doing that, as you know from the article that was in Nature this week. So thank you very much. I think there's great hope in Africa that Africa will finally be able to take hold of the agenda and help the good-meaning people in the North understand what the priorities are and what needs to be addressed to strengthen outbreak detection and response within Africa. Thank you.